lot better here in the sanctuary. Also, got a building going up for our bus out here that Casey and his crew are working on, and we appreciate that. And that's framed out and ready to put the metal on. And then we've got some plumbers coming over here too, doing some work on our sump pumps, so that we can pump all this water out of the church and get it out where it away from the building, so it's not doing any damage to the church. So there's lots of stuff going on around here during the week, and we're blessed to be able to do all of that work. So that is a joy. Any other joys to lift up this morning? Okay, if you would please take a moment and look at your list of prayer concerns. Do have some announcements as far as that goes. Trav, do you want to give us an update on Charlie?
Sitting up in his chair in the hospital in Dallas. Mom snuggled up sausage biscuit into him.
Okay. Charlie had a little bit of a setback, had an infection develop around the port that's in him, and he had to go back to the hospital in Plano, and so they're up there right now. And just covet your prayers. Hopefully they'll get to return home soon. I also visited with Corky Redden this week, and he sounded real good. He's getting his strength back. He's starting to eat some again. He's gained about 6 pounds. From the 40 that he lost in the treatment that he had, and so he's very optimistic and sounds good. They go back for a follow-up report, I think next week sometime, just to kind of see how everything's going, but he sounded real, real good. And then visited with Joe this week. Joe went down to MD Anderson for a report on his, and they found out that they didn't get his kidney out in time before the cancer spread to his lungs. So he's going to be leaving early Wednesday morning to go back to MD Anderson and get a biopsy and then start researching some treatment options for that. But we just need to keep this family in your prayers, wrap our arms around them and support them throughout this time of need in their life. So he covets our prayers, and we'll definitely give them to him. So that's what we need to do. Are there any other updates or additions to our prayer list this morning? Yes, Trina. Goodness. Okay, and I missed the name when you...
Peggy Murray.
All right, are there any others that we need to... Yes, Rhonda. So prayers for Luke Hale, injured his ankle in basketball game. Pray for a speedy recovery. He's gone through quite a bit this year and just wants to play. So let's pray for him to have a speedy recovery. Any other prayer requests this morning? Update. Yes, sir. Okay, Jay Gober's cancer has also returned. He starts treatment in Plano. So need to keep him and his family in our prayers also. Any others this morning? Okay, let's prepare our hearts to go to the Lord in prayer this morning.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. adore you.
Let's pray this morning. God, we come to you this morning. We're so thankful for this beautiful day that you've given us. A day that we can come into your house and just fellowship with one another and sing praises to you. Hear about all the good work that you're doing in the world through those who have answered your call and just grow closer to you this morning, God. So we pray that you would help us to put aside all the worries and cares of yesterday and tomorrow and just for this short time focus on what you might have to say to us today. We thank you for the blessings in our lives. We thank you for the rain that you've sent us, God. We pray that you would continue to send abundant rain to us throughout the winter months. We just thank you for family and friends, just the homes that we have, the food that we have, all of these blessings that sometimes we take for granted. Help us to always give you thanks and praise for the blessings in our lives. And we lift up these this morning who have been named and those that are on our prayer list this day. We pray that you would be with them in the way that they need you the most right now, God. We pray for Peggy Murray. She recovers from her accident. We pray that that would be a speedy recovery. We praise the Lord that she was not injured any more severely than she was and that she's okay now. We pray for Luke. Lord, we just pray that you would speed the recovery of his ankle so that he can play sports that he loves so much. Help his spirits to remain high. Keep him. Help him to know that you're there with him through this time. We pray for Jay Gober. As he begins his cancer treatment again, we just pray that this treatment would be successful, that you would heal his body of this cancer, and that you would be with his family through this time of trial in their lives. We pray for Charlie. We pray that you would just help him to regain his strength, that you would make a way, Lord, so that he could come home again. We pray for Sharon and the family, and just give them your strength and assurance that you're there with them through this time. We pray for Corky. We thank you, Lord, that he's feeling better, and we just pray that that cancer is completely gone and that when he goes back for his checkup that they won't find anything there. And, Lord, we pray for Joe. We pray, Lord, that you would keep his spirit strong, that you would just work through those doctors and nurses as they get a treatment plan together for him, that you would be with his family, that you would help them to know that we're here for them to help them through this time in their lives as well. Lord, we pray for our community. We pray for those this morning who may be living among us who may be all alone for Christmas. And we pray that you would help us to reach out to them in some way and let them know that they're not alone, that you're there and that you love them. We pray for our nation. We pray that you would raise up godly men and women to be leaders of our country, that they would stand on the promises of your word and not waver just because the culture says it's okay to. And we pray for our world. We pray for those who are refugees who can't find a place to stay. We pray for those who, of our brothers and sisters this morning, who can't come into a building like this and praise you, but they have to worship in secret for fear of their lives because they believe in you. We pray for their deliverance. And God, when we come to those times when we don't know what to say or even how to pray, help us to remember the prayer you taught your disciples when you prayed. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our song this morning is, Do You Hear What I Hear? And there's one line in here that I ask that you take this with you. And the line goes, pray for peace, people everywhere. And with all the turmoil that's going on throughout the world, that I hope that we pray for peace. At this time, I ask that you rise and join me in singing, Do You Hear What I Hear?
Do you see what I way up in the sky, little man. Do you see what I see? A star, dancing in the night with a tail as big as a kite. With a tail as big as a kite. Said the little lamb to the shepherd boy, do you hear what I hear? Ringing through the sky, shepherd boy.
Children come and we'll have our children's message this morning.
Good morning. Glad to see everybody here today. We've got Big Brother doing a good job over there. Watch out for that tree. Oh, y'all look so cute. You're matching. Okay, you want to put money in there? Thank you. Your little sister, thank you so much. Well, I am so very happy to see everybody this morning. Are y'all getting excited about something that's fixing to happen? Christmas. What are we getting excited about?
Christmas.
Yes, it's going to be. Everybody's going to have a break from school, and we're going to get to see our families. And very. Gonna get some Barbies. Brody said it was Jesus' birthday. Good job, Brody. Well, what I want to talk to you about today, if you're parents, I want y'all all to go home, and if you have a computer at your house, I want you to ask your mom and dad to find a video, and I want to show it to you. If I had been on my game, I would have brought my iPad and let you watch it up here this morning, but I didn't think about it. But there is a video on Facebook, and it is of some children in Walmart. And they're interviewing these children at Walmart. And they're asking, how many of you know what Walmart is? Raise your hand if you, okay. So everybody, okay, I didn't know. I was just checking, make sure everybody knows what Walmart is. Okay, well, they have these children in Walmart. And they told these children, they said, you can pick out, what would you pick out if you could pick out anything at Walmart in the toy section? And these kids were so excited, and they started talking about everything that they would like to have from Walmart. And then they asked the kids another question. And they said, what about if you could give your toy to somebody else that didn't have any toys for Christmas, what would you do? Brody, what? Tell me, turn around here.
Give them the toys that you don't need anymore.
Yes, that's very sweet. Cheyenne, what would you think?
Give them the toys that you just got.
Very good. Well, what they found in this video.
Give them the toys that you don't like.
Okay. So, well, somebody's bound to like it, right? That's right. That's right. Well, so what they found was that 80% of the children that they interviewed gave their favorite toy that they picked out, they gave it away to somebody who didn't have a toy. So that means 80% would be like, if there was 10 kids, 8 of them said, I'm going to give my Barbie doll to somebody that doesn't have a Barbie doll. So I thought that was really sweet. So I want to encourage y'all to go home and watch that video. Then another thing I want to talk about today is what is a gift? Now, you all are just little folks. Do any of you have a full-time job? No. Raise your hand if you do. Well, like where you get, like you go to work every day and get paid. I know that you have jobs at home, like if you help your mom pick up laundry or and feed the dog, that's a job. You feed the dog too? Take out the trash. Raina?
I never get asked to take out the trash. I just do it.
You don't even have to be asked. That's good. You've been trained well. And you pick up your toys. Good. Well, sometimes, do you know what the perfect gift you can give somebody is? It's something that doesn't cost money. It's free, and something that we all have, even though you might not have a full-time job. Love, and you can give people, when you give people your time, You're also giving them in patience. You're also giving them, that's a way of showing your love. So, did you hear Brother Jay say this morning or a while ago that we have some missionaries here that are going to talk to us today? The missionaries that are going to visit with us today, the Ostermans, they have been across the ocean helping other people. And you know what they've been giving them?
Love.
They have been giving them love. And they have done that not with a present that was wrapped up with a pretty bow on it, but they've been giving their time and their work. And so that is something that even though all of you don't have a full-time job and it's hard for you to go to Walmart and buy big gifts for everybody, you can always give people your time. And when you give people your time, that's also a way of giving them love. So you could give your time and your love to your classmates at school. You can give your time and love to your next door neighbor, maybe that doesn't have a lot of visitors. You can give your time just by stopping and taking the time to give somebody a hug, or going across the street and just visiting for a little bit. That's a way that you guys, y'all are young, and y'all can start being missionaries, okay? All right, everybody, let's bow our heads, okay? Dear Lord, I thank you for all these children here today. And Lord, help us as a church to help foster in them a sense of giving, and help us to set good examples so that they will learn as they grow up to lead a life that's giving, and whether it be a missionary here at home or wherever you lead them in their lives, dear Lord, we just ask, Lord, that as a church we can foster that growth within them and help them to see that that is your will and the way that you would like for them to go. We just ask that you bless each and every one of these children and be with them this week. These things we pray in your Son's holy and blessed name. Amen. All right, y'all have a good week.
Well, speaking of our missionaries, we are very, very blessed to have Clint and Vicki Osterman here with us today, along with their children, Peyton, Morgan, and Olivia. And we're just so glad that they're here in worship with us today. And I tell you, it's one thing to answer a call to go into full-time overseas missions as an individual, but to go as a whole family, that's a special calling indeed. And that it's not just for one person, it's for the whole family. And they've been doing some amazing things over there. If you've been keeping up with them from Heart for Uganda on their website and in their blog, it's just amazing what they're doing. And Clint's going to come up at this time, and he's going to share a brief report with you on what all they're doing over there in Uganda. And y'all give him a round of applause.
I'm going to start a timer so I don't talk too long. So as Pastor Jay said, we're Clint and Vicki. We've been married for 17 years, and we have Peyton, who's 12, and Morgan's 10, and Olivia's 6. And we've been in Uganda for the last year and a half, and some of you may have remembered, we came here before we left and spoke, and I want to thank you for all the support that you've given us. You guys have been a real blessing to us, one of our biggest supporters of the work that we do. So thank you very much.
Which one
for? The PowerPoint. And so we've been in Uganda, like I said, for the last 18 months. And so why Uganda? We felt called there. Vicky's sister Vanessa has served there for the last 8 or 9 years or so. And so we felt called there. And there's a lot of issues there. And one thing that we found is there's a lot of youth. It's the youngest population in the world, with an average age of 15 and a half. And we've also the highest unemployment percentage in Africa. So we left from here, we created an organization that's a 501c3 nonprofit corporation called Heart for Uganda. And so the mission of Heart for Uganda is to empower individuals and organizations to meet their own needs in culturally relevant and sustainable ways. That's our mission statement. But how we do that is through first discipleship, then vocational training, business training, and leadership and management training. We start with discipleship because we feel that that's the heart of the matter. That's the root cause of a lot of other issues. And so we do that, you can go through those pictures there. We do that through individual Bible studies. We do that through discipleship classes. We've had four different discipleship classes that we've done. There are 40-week courses that we do that we spend time going through God's Word and equipping these people. And so we start at the heart. We start at the root through discipleship. One of my mentors in Uganda said that if we just teach people how to get a job or make more money, then we've only made a smoother path to hell for them, unless we share the gospel with them. And so that's the most important, that's the most critical piece that we have. So we do that next through vocational training. So we teach them a job skill so that they can earn an income for their family. We want to see godly husbands, fathers, community members, and we want to see them provide for their own needs without relying on outside handouts. There's a big problem in many parts of Africa called the dependency syndrome, where people are dependent on handouts. And so we want to see them come from that to be able to provide for their families themselves. And the main way we do that is, the main vocation we teach is farming. So Uganda should be the breadbasket of Africa. They have two rainy seasons, fertile soil, but Uganda is a net importer of food. They're importing food from countries that only have one rainy season. And so that's a huge problem. Farming God's way was created in South Africa and has moved up to almost all of Africa and has spread throughout the world. And it's a farming practice that results in about 7 to 10 times yield over traditional farming practices. But it has a discipleship piece built into it. So we have great crops, and people come and ask us, how are you growing this? What kind of hybrid seeds are we using? And so we're able to teach them the gospel through that, because we're using open pollination seeds. So they reproduce after their own kind as God intended. And so we use that to teach them about how God is all-sufficient. That's one of the biblical pieces in farming God's way, is that God is all-sufficient. And so we teach them about how God is all-sufficient to provide a solution for our sins through His Son, Jesus Christ. And so we have different... I want to show you this picture here real quick, the one that just... Scroll back down to that first one there, Candy. So these crops were planted within 2 days of each other. The one on the left was planted 2 days before the one on the right. The one on the left is a prison farm, planted traditional farming, and the one on the right is our crops planted using farming God's way. And there's a huge difference there. And so these pictures were taken on the same day, and that farm is on the way out to our farm. So you can go through those pictures. We teach individual weekend courses, and we also teach at a seminary. We teach about 40 pastors. That's them there at a seminary called Global Theological Seminary. We have a farm, 22 acres, that's located in the second highest Muslim population in Uganda. And so we use that farm as a training center to teach farming God's way, and to also teach our vocational training and to do discipleship. So on our farm, we have, this is an aerial photo of our farm there. It's, as you can see, it's very green and very beautiful there. Should be growing great crops. So in the next picture there is we have maize and beans is what we start out growing. Because that's kind of staple crops in Uganda, but we're going to expand our farm to do more, so keep going. So that's another picture of our amazing beans there. We also have comparison gardens, where we show the difference between farming God's way and traditional farming. Okay. And this is a picture of our traditional farming on the left and farming God's way on the right. This is Alex. Alex is one of our success stories. We were able to lead him to Christ through evangelism, disciple him, and then he's come on as our farm manager. So he's been a real blessing to us. We use composting as inputs for our fields. So that's our compost heap there. Okay. We do bee farming, beekeeping. We also do other vocations. We teach small engine repair. And we're hoping to add carpentry, masonry, and welding to our mix down the road. Okay? And that one didn't come. So, that's okay. So we teach small engine repair. There are hundreds of thousands of motorcycle taxis all over Uganda, so it's a way that people can have a job with ready employment. We also teach business training so that they can take the skills that they've learned and create a business with that. And then management and leadership training. We want these men to be trained and go back to their village and teach others and be mentors for the youth. So it came up all right. Yep. And that's a business class that we teach at Global Theological Seminary. And we do several others as well. Okay. And then our long-term plans, we want to keep growing our farm, create a sustainable farm so that the farm can provide all the money that we need to run all of our vocational training there. And then you guys are already helping us with our monthly support, so thank you very much, and thank you for the prayers that you've given us. These are some of our guys that the money that you are supporting us, we're able to support these people on the farm and through our ministries, and these kids are able to go to school because of y'all's support for us. We have a newsletter and Facebook. I have a brochure I'll pass out at the end with all of that information, so you can keep up with us. And then our website's heartforuganda.com. So can you play the video? Thank you.
He's going to pull it up on his laptop, Candy, and see if we can show it. You want to turn that now, or do you want to wait till later in the service? Or it doesn't matter. While they're working on that, I just wanted you guys to know that this is real stuff. Okay, this is God moving in the lives of people. Oh, now it's going to play. It's buffering. But, you know, the money that you guys have been giving in pledges, it's making a huge difference in the lives of people. And so I want to encourage you to continue with those pledges. If there's maybe some of you out there this morning who didn't get an opportunity to give a pledge to the Ostermans and their work in Uganda. And if you'd like to do so, you can, you know, email me or get in touch with me and we can get that set up for you to do that. It's really, you know, God's money doing something really awesome in another part of the world. You know, we're called to do missions here in Throckmorton. We're called to do missions in the United States, but we're also called to do missions around the world. It's kind of it's a both and type. type of deal. It's not just one or the other. And so I'm glad that they were here today to do that. We're going to play this video right quick. I think we'll try it here.
Uganda has the youngest population in the world, with 77% of its population being under 30 years old. Of these youth, 83% are unemployed. This is the highest percentage of unemployed youth in Africa. Unemployment is often the root cause of problems such as HIV/AIDS, orphans, malnutrition, and a lack of education. We seek to address the cause of the bleeding instead of putting a bandage on it. This is where Heart for Uganda comes in.
Heart for Uganda seeks to equip and empower these men, first through discipleship, then through vocational, business, and leadership training. Discipleship is central to everything that we do, because poverty is more than just a physical problem. It's also a spiritual and emotional problem. We teach these men who they are in Christ and how to be godly husbands, fathers, businessmen, and community members. We have to address the heart before we address any other problem. We teach important job skills such as farming and small engine repair. These are skills that can immediately be transitioned into a job or small business. Farming is the central vocation that we teach because it is estimated that 75% of all Ugandans engage in agriculture. We use a tool called Farming God's Way that has already been developed, has been successful all over Africa, and has discipleship built into it.
People have been coming to see our crops and they have been saying this is the best crops that I've seen all over around.
Small engine repair is also an important vocation that we teach because there are motorcycle taxis all over Uganda and a need for mechanics to repair them. This means that their skills can immediately transition into a job or a small business. We also teach these men business training so that they can take the job skills that they have and transition them into a small business. We teach the men management and leadership skills so that they can take the training they have received back to their home village, train others, and be godly role models for the youth.
Ephesians 4 teaches us to put off the old self, renew our minds, and to put on the new self. This is the aim of Heart for Uganda. We desire to see men providing for their families instead of accepting handouts. We want to see less orphans, malnutrition, less cases of HIV/AIDS, and more kids in school. This is our heart for Uganda.
This is our heart for Uganda.
This is our heart for Uganda.
Thanks again, guys, for all the hard work that you guys are doing over there. We're blessed to be able to partner with you in that. And so at this time, if I could have some ushers gather in the back, we'll take our offering this morning. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we pray that you would just bless this offering that we give. May we give with cheerful hearts, understanding that these funds are going to be used for your glory, not only here in Throckmorton, but around the world. In Christ's name. Amen.
Please rise for the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him, above the heavenly host. Praise God, the Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
You may be seated. One of the things that when I visited with Joe this week, he said that we're going to need our church family to be around us during this time that we're going through. And so we're going to invite Joe and his family. If you guys would come down here this morning, we want to give you a prayer shawl. So y'all come on down. We don't have room at the altar to kneel. So
no,
if you just want to sit or stand, we would like to surround you and bless you as you go through this time. So we're going to invite everybody to come down.
And it's not really a shawl for Joe. It's kind of a lap shawl. And he can sit whenever, whatever's happening. That is one thing he said this week to me was, he is blessed because he has a church family to help him through this. No, let's put that on the man. Don't let it be like, wrap it around him as y'all touch. Let's do this right. And for you new ones that are here, you need to touch somebody who's touching the shawl and make a chain till we're all connected together as one church family. Okay, is everybody? Wait, hold on. Everyone linked? Okay, bow your heads. Here's the blessing we're going to put in on the shawl. And when I finish and say amen, say your own little blessings before you break to God. Dear God, as Joe wraps himself in this prayer shawl of comfort, may he find comfort when all that appears too much to bear at this moment. May he find comfort from all that feels as if it might be his breaking point. May he find comfort from all that seems to threaten his peace of heart. May he be comforted by the presence of those who love and support him. May he be comforted by his faith in you, Lord. May he be strengthened in the days that follow, knowing that he has a church family praying for him. May God bless you, Joe. Amen.
Well, we've already had quite a service this morning, so I'll try to keep it short and sweet for the message today. But there is something I feel like God wants to share with us today through His Word. We've been talking about the miracle of Christmas in this Advent series, and this morning we're going to talk about the miracle of the method that God used to bring salvation into the world. And our scripture passage this morning is Romans 11:33. Doesn't really seem like a Christmas passage of Scripture, but I think when you think about it, it can be. Romans 11:33. Hear the word of the Lord this morning. Oh, the depth of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable His judgments and His paths beyond tracing out. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You know, part of the miracle of Christmas is this miracle of the method. God's methods are beyond our comprehension. Paul states this in this short little doxology, you know, that God's ways, His wisdom, the depths of His wisdom go beyond anything that we can possibly comprehend. And isn't that the way it needs to be? I mean, I've heard people say sometimes, and I've heard people talk that, you know, unless I can answer all the questions, unless I can completely wrap my mind around this God, then I'm not going to believe in Him. Well, I would say to you this morning that it would be a very small God indeed, would it not, if we could completely comprehend everything there was to know about God? It's not possible. God is bigger than we could ever imagine. God's ways are beyond anything that we can comprehend, and that's the way it's supposed to be. The created is not supposed to ever know as much about, you know, everything about their creator. I mean, think about God. Isaiah 55 verses 8 through 9 says this about God. This is God speaking. He says, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways and my thoughts than your thoughts." God's methods are different than our methods. And we shouldn't be surprised at this. We've studied some of these characters in the Bible, and we've seen how God has used just some regular, ordinary people to do some extraordinary things. I mean, He chose Abraham. There was nothing that special about Abraham. He chose him to leave his home. He said, "Just go." Didn't tell him where he was going. "Just go till I tell you to stop, and I'm going to make a great nation out of you." You know, He chose Joseph. You know, the little spoiled, rotten brat in the family of Jacob. You know, the second youngest. He used him to save his entire family and the entire nation of Israel. He chose the nation of Israel, probably the least significant nation in the world at the time, to be His chosen people. He chose David, you know, the run of the litter in Jesse's house, a shepherd boy, to be king of Israel. And He chose the town of Bethlehem, this small, insignificant little village right outside of Jerusalem, to be the birthplace of His son. Over and over and over again, God has chosen plain, ordinary people and places to do His extraordinary work. How impossible is it for us to understand God's methods? You know, Luke records in his account of Christ's birth that Mary and Joseph traveled to Bethlehem to register for the census. While there, the time came for the baby to be born. She wrapped her son in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. They stayed where the animals stayed and put the Son of God in a feed trough. Joseph, you know, being a good husband, probably at least tried to clean out the feed trough and maybe put some fresh hay in there for the child, but they were still in a stable. And to celebrate the occasion, the angels come, and did they proclaim the birth of Christ to the kings of the world? Did they go to the temple in Jerusalem and proclaim it from the top of the temple? No. They went out into the fields and proclaimed it to the people who were shunned by the rest of society, the lowly shepherds out keeping their flocks by night. The most unlikely of recipients get to hear the news of the birth of Christ. You know, the more you think about it, the more, you know, incredible this birth story of Christ becomes. You know, none of us, if we were going to write about the birth of God into the world, I doubt any of us would have come up with this story. You know, think about this miracle of the method for just a moment. You know, even after His resurrection from the dead, Jesus first appeared to a group of women. And in Jewish society, you know, women weren't seen as anything much more important than property. And yet the very first people He chose to appear to are women. He didn't show up at the temple. I mean, if I was writing this story, He would have come back to life and He would have gone right to the Sanhedrin and He would have said, "God, I got you. Told you so." But He didn't do it. God's plan was different. Following His resurrection, Jesus reveals Himself to His followers, and He gives them the responsibility of sharing the good news of Jesus Christ with the rest of the world. He says, "I'm going to my Father. You guys go and make disciples, baptizing them and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded them to do." Think about that for just a second. He left the salvation of the world in the hands of a bunch of fishermen, a tax collector, a zealot, and a bunch of just ordinary nobodies. And they did it. They did it. They changed history. They changed the way we tell time. We went from BC to AD because of these guys. I mean, they did the impossible. Paul commented on this miracle of the method, that God uses ordinary people to accomplish His ordinary work, when he wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 26 through 29. Listen to these words from Paul. Brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before Him. See, God's methods haven't changed. He still chooses to use ordinary people to accomplish His extraordinary work. Our abilities are not as important as our attitude and our availability. A wise friend of mine one time said, you know, God doesn't call the qualified. He qualifies the called. All He asks is that we be willing to say, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, I'll do it. I'll do whatever you need me to do. Then He promises in His word that He will give us the tools that we need. He will give us the words to say. He will give us the support that we need to accomplish His will in the world. But there's a little bit more to it than just that. See, God is at work in our lives in ways that we cannot fully comprehend. In the same way that we would have written the script differently concerning the redemption of mankind, I'm sure we would probably also write the script a whole lot differently when it comes to our sanctification. Now, for those of you that don't know, sanctification is just a big fancy word for the process that you're going through to become like Jesus. When you first come to know the Lord as your Savior, you become justified before the Lord, and then you begin the process of sanctification. And over the time of your life, you grow closer to Him and you grow in your faith and you seek to become more and more like Jesus. And a lot of times, if we were going to write that script, I know I would write it this way, it would be awesome. I mean, I would never stop growing in my love and devotion for Him. It would just be moving upward the whole time. I would never have any more problems. Life would be heavenly bliss for me until the day I went home to be with the Lord. That's the way it would be if I wrote the script. But is that life? No. We all experience problems, pains, and pressures. We experience struggles. We experience sickness. We experience temptations and failures. A lot of times we take one step forward in our spiritual growth, and the next thing we know, we've taken three steps back. There's victories and there's defeats. It's not the way we would have it. Now, I can't answer all your questions as to why some things have happened to you in your life. But I can tell you that when you're going through circumstances we don't understand, we're not left to despair. We can trust that God is at work in our lives for our good. We must choose to believe that God is working to shape us and mold us so that we become more like Jesus. And this requires us to believe what He has promised to us in Romans 8:28. When He says, "And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose." You know, when the angel appeared to Mary to tell her that she would be the mother of God's Son, there's no way that she could have known what that really meant. Joseph had no idea what would have been involved when he obediently responded to the angel's message and took Mary as his wife. Joseph and Mary endured shame, accusation, embarrassment, and ridicule. But they also got to experience the miracle of seeing God become flesh, right before their eyes. I remember the first time I ever saw somebody doing a needlepoint. Anybody in here do needlepoint? Or have seen somebody do needlepoint? My grandmother was working on some needlepoint one time, and I remember watching her push the needle and the thread, all the different colors, and I was watching her do it, and I was looking at what she was doing, and it looked all ugly. And it was just a bunch of different colors and knots and just a ragtag group of different things, and it didn't look like anything. And I said, "Grandmother, that's ugly." And she said, "Well, honey, you're looking at the back." And she flipped it over, and there was this beautiful picture that she was making. You know, God's at work in our lives, and He's building a beautiful tapestry. But from our perspective here on earth, oftentimes we're looking at the back of the embroidery. We're looking at the underneath, and we don't understand why it looks so ugly and it seems so confusing, and it's impossible for us to understand all the different knots and colors and seemingly random directions our lives have taken. But one day, we will finally be able to see the front of the tapestry that God has been weaving in us. We will then be able to see how the seasons of pain brought some rich, vibrant colors to our tapestry. We'll see the fullness and richness of the design reflected in the seasons of joy and celebration. We will see the depth of character revealed through the times of testing and trusting. Therefore, we must continue to trust that He is at work and that He is working for our good. Continue to trust God. Even though you don't understand how He is at work in your life right now, continue to follow Him and your life will be richly blessed. The miracle of the method is that God uses ordinary people just like you and me to accomplish extraordinary things for the kingdom of God. The miracle of the method is also that God is at work in our lives in ways that we don't understand. Therefore, we must choose to trust what we know to be true because of what He has revealed to us through His Son. We must choose to believe that God is working in us and through us for our good and for His glory. He's at work weaving a beautiful tapestry that will one day be revealed for all to see. Let's pray. God of the universe, Heavenly Father, oh, how wonderful You are. How great are Your riches, wisdom, and knowledge. But we would also confess that it is impossible for us to completely understand Your methods. Your ways are not our ways, nor are Your thoughts our thoughts. Forgive us for trying to fit You into a neat little box. We confess that many times we feel frustrated and confused by the things that happen in our lives. Help us to remember that You love us and are at work in our lives for our good and for Your glory. Help us to continue to trust You, even when we don't understand how You're working. Lord, You have chosen to use ordinary people to accomplish extraordinary things for Your kingdom. Please use me. I ask You, Lord, to please take my life and use me in whatever way You decide to extend Your kingdom here on earth. Thank You for the confidence You've placed in me by entrusting to me the responsibility of sharing the good news of salvation with those around me. And I pray that each of us can pray this prayer that we would also say, "Use me, Lord." Thank You for loving us through all that You do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. During our closing hymn this morning, I said if you received your little envelope for the barren tree offering while we're singing the hymn, you're welcome at any time during the song to come up and hang that on the tree as your offering as we sing our closing hymn this morning.
We'll remain seated while we sing number 218, "It Came Upon the Midnight Clear."
Please receive this benediction. May the Lord Jesus Christ, through the power of the Holy Spirit and to the honor and glory of God the Father, bless you and keep you and help you to know that may, even though you may not understand what's going on in your life, God is weaving a beautiful tapestry that will bring Him glory and give you purpose in life. Go now from this place and do what He has asked you to do. Amen.